So let's start talking a little bit about interpretive flexibility and then talk about interpretive flexibility of the automobile from a user and from a producer standpoint. Okay? So when the early car was produced, it was originally, again, kind of a status symbol, a status item, right? It was something that wealthy country people or wealthy city people could use. You know, they call it the devil wagon, all this stuff. And they could use it, you know, for rip-roaring around, having a good time, showing off their money. I mean, it's actually quite similar to, I don't know, someone that drives a Porsche or a Ferrari, you know, when they only drive 10 miles to work every day. It's, you know, it's very much a status symbol. But slowly, automobile manufacturers started to make cars for common people, such as farmers. And it was kind of, I don't want to use the words unintentional, because when we talk about interpretive flexibility, the producers would make vehicles, at least initially, kind of knowing that people might modify them. Right? There was not, they didn't think too much about it, but they knew that people might modify them. Here's actually a picture on page 786 of interpretive flexibility of the automobile. So it's a postcard showing different uses of the Model T on the firm. And this is where user interpretive flexibility really takes off. So you think of a car as a device that gets you from point A to point B. Okay, the city people use it to show off and things like that, are also so they could travel further, you know, more, you know, conventional uses that we think of an automobile. But farmers, what they do is they jack up the rear tires and see that axle spins on the rear tires, right? And so they would hook up belts to these spinning axles, and it could be used to power things like butter churns, washing machines. It could also be used to hook up to like kind of tractor apparatus. So it was a way for farmers to basically have a portable power supply, and they could turn their cars into tractors, right? That was kind of cool. At the same time, you had producer flexibility that was occurring as well. They made cars that could be kind of re-engineered to suit the needs of the user. So it could be a car, it could be a pickup truck, and some of them even sold conversion kits so that their cars could be turned into tractors and other things, right? So both the user and the producer expressed interpretive flexibility. As the producer, we want you to be able to modify the vehicle, and as the producer, we want you to be able to modify the vehicle, and as the user, you want to be able to use a car for much more than just going from point A to point B, right? And this is where the automobile really gets kind of interesting. But this is the concept of interpretive flexibility. A car was used for things that not originally intended, but it was something that kind of grew. And of course, you have these follow-on manufacturers that sell their own kinds of conversion kits for vehicles as well, right? They can sell their own tractor conversion kits, their own you know, belts and all sorts of different things, so that basically the car could be used as a power source for really anything. Okay. Now you're probably thinking, well, that's great. I mean, that's a car, but you know, do we have any relevant examples of this today? You bet we do. Think about the internet. The internet is so broad, right? And when you think about what the internet was originally used for, from what I understand, it was kind of like a military database. Some universities started getting it. You know, you can look up people's phone numbers, locations, addresses, very simple things. And, you know, then it started developing. And now you think about the internet. The internet is anything you want to be, basically. You can do software programming on the internet. You can do, the number of uses for the internet are basically limitless, right? And the producers, the original kind of makers of the internet, had kind of designed it with that interpretive flexibility in mind, and that has allowed creators to come up with almost anything, right? Or you think about something like the App Store, like if you have Mac products. In the App Store, you know, they'll sell any kind of app that passes, you know, muster from Mac's, Apple's perspective, and that gives the users, I guess you could call them users or producers of apps. Users of the App Store or producers of the apps, depending on what perspective you want to look at it. But it allows people that make apps to produce almost anything and put it out there. So this is also interpretive flexibility in action, right? Hopefully this makes sense. So in our next video, we're going to talk about how the automobile especially with his interpretive flexibility, winds up transforming America. Hope you enjoyed this video. As always, give me a thumbs up if you like it. Comment down below. Make sure you subscribe.